Hello, Mr. True again. Today's topic is going to be inverse functions. Okay, so we got some notes. I'm going to try and run through a lot of examples here in the next 15 minutes to help you out as much as I can. We are going to be checking if two functions are actually inverses. To do that, you have to go through the composition process of doing f of g of x and making sure that equals x. And then you have to reverse that composition and do g of x is equal to, g of f of x and make sure that's equal to x. If both of these checks work, then your two functions that you're given are actually inverses. To find an inverse function algebraically, though that's not going to be the first example we take a look at, you're going to switch the x and y variables, resolve your equation for y, and then once you get that new y by itself, you're going to take it out and relabel it with a negative 1. That'll indicate you're done finding the inverse and that the equation left actually, is that inverse you were looking for. First, though, we're going to take a look at inverses graphically. So, I've got this function here, this f of x. If you've been watching my videos and you looked at the transformation video recently, you might recognize this graph. We've got 0 here. From this point, if I move over 4 places, the square root of 4 is 2. And if I keep going over 9 places, the square root of 9 is 3. So you might recognize this as a square root function, but the graph does not start at the origin. Instead, it starts at 2. So actually, this is the equation f of x equals the square root of x minus 2. With that plus or minus inside the function, it's a left to right movement. And that minus 2 indicates a movement to the right. We're not doing transformations today, but I just thought I'd toss that out there for you. Okay, so we're looking at this function, which is a square root function, but nah, that's okay. I just want a function, just a graph. And I want to talk about graphically what does inverses look like. Well, the hint is right here algebraically. You switch the x and y variables to do your inverse algebraically. Well, that's going to be the same thing we do with our graph, where we have an x and y axis. Graphically, how you do this inverse is you reflect the line, you reflect the graph around the line y equals x. Reflect about the line y equals x. Y-intercept is 0, slope of 1. And when I take this graph and I reflect it around the line y equals x, that line is effectively going to switch the x and y variables. So instead of my graph going along the x-axis, it's going to flip over the line, reflect over the line, and go along the y-axis. So this point, which was 2, 0 in my reflected graph, is going to be 0, 2. My point that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 2 is now going to become 2, 6. So you're also, again, just taking those x and y's and flipping them. 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then finally, my other one is 11, 3. So instead of 11, 3, it's going to be 3, 11. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Then I'm off the screen. So let me just draw through the points that I do have. This red line is f of, the inverse of x, or the inverse of f of x, sorry about that. So you take a graph, you reflect it around the line y equals x, and you get an inverse. Now, is it an inverse function? Well, that's what this is about. Only one-to-one functions, I have this in white to match my white original graph. Only one-to-one functions will have an inverse function. Well, you know a function means each x only has one y, right? We normally check that with the vertical line test. Well, my original graph would pass my vertical line test because no matter where I draw my horizontal line, it'll only cross once. Well, for this function to have an inverse function, it must also pass the horizontal line test. So no matter where I, I'm going to match this line here, but no matter where I put my horizontal lines, I'm only ever going to cross once. So vertical line test is passed, they only ever cross once. All the horizontal lines pass. I cannot draw a horizontal line and have it cross more than once. That's why when I take this graph and I flip it over the line y equals x, I get, look, it is an inverse, and if I pass my vertical lines through here, which were horizontal, I'm going to pass that line test. So only one-to-one functions will give you an inverse function. And that's a graphical check for that. To give you another example of this one-to-one idea, if I take and say this is my graph, let's say it looks like this. Well, that's a function, right? But if I were to pass some horizontal lines through it, but here it would cross 1, 2, 3 times. This graph kind of goes up to the up towards the y-axis. If I were to flip it around the line y equals x, the attempt at making an inverse function would bring this area down over here, and it would look something like, ooh, this one's going to be tough, something like this. I'm not sure if this is the best graph, but actually I know it's not. But it's something like that. And look, see, in certain areas I can draw vertical lines, and this inverse after the reflection over the line y equals x would not pass the function test. So vertical and horizontal has to pass both of those for a function to have an inverse function. Okay, well that's all with pictures. Let's take a look at some actual problems. F of x is equal to x cubed plus 2. I want to find the inverse of this equation. And I'm also going to drop the function notation for now. And I want to find the inverse. Take the x and y variables and switch them. So x equals y cubed plus 2. Now I want to resolve this for y. Okay? I'm going to subtract 2 from both sides and get x minus 2 equals y cubed, and I need to finish solving for y, so I'm going to take the cube root of both sides and get the cube root of x minus 2 equals y. I've resolved for y, so I've switched my x and y's, I've solved for y, and now I'm just going to make sure that I denote that this is an inverse function. So I have an original function and my inverse function. Did I make any mistakes? Are these indeed inverse functions? Well, let's check it. Just temporarily, I'm going to call this f of x, and this one g of x. Why? Because I'm trying to match the way the notes are given in the textbook about finding or checking for inverse functions. You have to do your composition both ways. So f and g, my original function, my inverse function. Let's check it. F of g of x. Well, function f is something cubed plus 2. So this is equal to something cubed plus 2. Well, what's getting plugged in? G. Well, g is the cube root of x minus 2. So inside here, I didn't leave myself very much room. I plug in my cube root of x minus 2. My next example will be written a little better, bigger. Well, the power of 3 and the cube of 3, cube root of 3, will cancel each other out because the square root or the radical symbol, is acting as a grouping symbol. So all of this is being given the power of 3, and all of it was also originally wrapped with a third root. They're going to cancel out. We get x minus 2 plus 2, and that comes out to be x. So my first check is worked. Now let's make sure my second one does. Does g of f of x come out to also be x? Well, let's see. G of f of x. G is the cube root of x plus, the cube root of x minus 2. So that's going to be the cube root of something minus 2. And what's that something that we're plugging in? Well, we're plugging in f, see, g of f, and f is x cubed plus 2. So x cubed plus 2. Well, now look what's going to happen. 2 and negative 2 cancel out, and we get the cube root of x cubed. And once again, the power of 3 and the cube will cancel out, power of 3 and the cube root, and we get an answer of x. So once I found my inverse function, I checked it through the composition process, and both times got a value of x. So I didn't make any mistakes, and these truly are inverse functions. Let's do another example. Okay, let's take a look at f of x, excuse me, my notes are written with function notation, y is equal to 3 divided by x minus 2. We want to find the inverse function, so we're going to take those x and y's, swap them around, and x equals 3 minus y minus 2, or 3 divided by y minus 2. I got to solve that for y, so I'm going to add 2 to both sides, and get x plus 2 equals 3 over y. I cannot solve for a variable when it's in the denominator. So, multiply it to both sides. I'm going to multiply the left and right side by y to cancel that out, and we end up with y times x plus 2 equals 3. Well, now I got my y times something else. I'm trying to get y by itself. How do you undo multiplication? You divide. So y, after you divide both sides by x plus 2, comes out to be 3 divided by x plus 2. Now that I've got my y alone again, I have finished finding the inverse, and I'm going to denote it with my exponent of negative 1. As far as a check, well, let's again call this f of x temporarily, and let's call this g of x, and let's just make sure we didn't make any mistakes. Okay, so is, here's my check, f of g of x, is it going to come out to be x? Well, f is 3 divided by something minus 2. That x is your something. What's going into that empty spot? G of x. G of x is 3 over x plus 2. Now, have you been watching my videos? If you have, you've seen me deal with this fraction over a fraction, or it's 3 over 1 over 3 over x plus 2. And you'll know that I do this little crazy pigtail notation to say flip the bottom up. That's going to undo the division. When you divide fractions, you multiply by the reciprocal of the second number, and that's always going to be the bottom. So this comes out to be 3 over 1 times x plus 2 over 3 minus 2. The multiplication and division of 3 cancel out. We get x plus 2 minus 2, and indeed that does equal x. And I'm going to try really quick to finish the other form or the other composition before my 15 minutes are up. So does g of f of x come out to be x? Well, g is 3 over something plus 2. What's that something we're plugging in? 3 over x minus 2. What do we got here? Negative 2 and positive 2 will cancel out. We get 3 over x. That bottom fraction, when you divide fractions, you can't divide by fractions, so you multiply by the reciprocal, and it becomes 3 over 1 times x over 3. 3's cancel out. Bada bing, bada boom, bam! There you go, a couple of examples and some definitions and how to do inverse functions. Thank you very, very much. Woo!